Thank you for joining us for our Wednesday night Bible study. We're thankful that you're here. Those of you who are joining us on live stream, welcome. Let's stand and let's open our service room by singing hymn 273. Asking tonight that you speak to us, Lord. Fill our hearts that we would leave here knowing we've met with you, that we would leave here changed, that we would leave here, Lord, just knowing you more than we do now. And I do pray that the Holy Spirit, Lord, would just be our teacher this evening. And Lord, just pray that all distractions and all other thoughts be put aside, and Lord, that our focus would be wholly on you and on the Word of God. Pray for Pastor as he brings us the word tonight and preaches, and I pray, Lord, that you would bless him. Bless us, Lord, this evening. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
All right, we're going to look in Philippians chapter 4. It's a lesson we actually started last week. I did go ahead and add to it. That's why you have a new lesson plan. And if you want to just write in the things on the back of your plan from lesson from last week, you can. We'll go through and give you the fill-ins to catch you up if you're first time doing this lesson. And Philippians chapter 4, notice in verse 10 it says, "But I rejoice in the Lord greatly that now at the last your care of me hath flourished again, wherein ye also careful, but ye lack opportunity. Not that I speak in respect of want, for I've learned in whatsoever state I am, therewith be content. I know both how to be abased, and I know how to abound everywhere in all things. I am instructed both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. I can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth me. Notwithstanding, ye have well done that ye did communicate with my affliction." And so our text verse is verse 13, and it says, "I can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth me." And we're thankful that the Apostle Paul lays out for us the struggles and problems and difficulties he had in his life, ministering and preaching the Word of God. And he came to the conclusion, because God just took care of him over and over again, that he could do all things through Christ which strengtheneth him. Our lesson plan, as you can see, is called Christian Impossibilities. You say, well, he's saying I can do all things. That's everything that's possible. as we started out last week, we just kind of highlighted some things in the Christian life that are impossible. And it's not because of the lacking of God, it's just the experience that we have. And so all things are possible. But in Matthew chapter 19, verse 26, we fill in there is, but Jesus beheld them and said unto them, with men this is impossible, but with God all things are possible. And so God does give us possibilities and opportunities to be able to accomplish many things. Now, in the Hebrews chapter 11, you see, but without faith, it's impossible to please him. And oftentimes people try to appease God, try to get approval from God. And the reality is, if you're not living and you're not functioning in faith, it's impossible to please the Lord. And so Christian impossibilities, there are impossibilities that come into our life. And we saw, first of all, Roman numeral 1 in your notes, it's impossible to hide a good testimony. And the Lord dealt with this. It helped us understand that. Letter A is just simply this, your light. Jesus said, let your light so shine before men that they might be able to see your good works. And so it's impossible to hide your light, because your light really is your life. Your life is a shining light to the world that is in darkness. And the world just really seems like it just keeps getting darker and darker. And if it is getting darker and darker, then our testimony, our life, all will become lighter and lighter. And so your life is shining, whether it's your family or neighbors, work, co-workers, whatever, your life, it's hard to hide or to cover a testimony in a life that is shining for the Lord. And so I gave an example there, number 2, of the Twin Lights Lighthouse up in Sandy Hook. I haven't been up there, my wife and I have been up there for years, but we went up there quite a few different times. And you can't hide that, it's sitting on a hill. And so it's easy for ships to be able to see the lighthouse. And that's what we need to do. We need to be like a light that's sitting on a hill, shining to everyone, so that our testimony and our life is not hid from others. And then last week we had those get baptized. So I think of those getting baptized. Every time we have baptism service, it's exciting because you just see the testimony of those that have surrendered their life to Christ. And they go in the water of baptism. They're excited about that. They come out. I mean, there's just, when you have baptisms, there's an energy that's present, that isn't present in every service. And so I always think about those who get baptized, how their light is shining. You can't hide that testimony. Then I put down your, not only your light, but letter B is just simply this, your audience. Jesus said, let your light so shine before men. And so realize this, that you have to have a constant witness. And that constant witness is your life, your testimony that is shining before men. And so it's, you can't hide that. The audience is always there. And I remember I was down in Dividing Creek. I was working on one of the church members' house, because it was the lawnmower was broke. I don't know if you remember what was wrong with it. But anyway, I took it over there to work on it, because he had all kinds of tools. He was retired, and he was a mechanic and a machinist and all of this, that, and the other. So I went over to use his tools, and I'm working on it. I couldn't get it apart when I needed to get apart. And I said to him, I said, you know, man, this thing is really being a problem. I said, it won't come apart here. And he said, yeah, I'm watching to see if you're going to lose your temper or not. I thought, well, why don't you get down here and take it apart yourself, amen? But anyway, you cannot hide your testimony. There's always an audience. There's always somebody that's watching. And so we need to be careful about that. And I'm just thinking not only the constant witness, but that children's song we always used to sing. And we were little kids, this little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. And so that's what we need to do. We need to have that mentality that we need to let our light so shine before men. And then we talked about, letter C is your good works, fulfilling his good works. Then Roman number 2, we talked about the impossible to serve two masters. And Jesus was very clear about that in Matthew chapter 6. You cannot have it both ways. People want to have their foot in the world, and then they want their foot in the church. They want to serve God, but then they want to be consumed with serving the Lord, the world and the devil. And so, impossible to serve two masters. Here's where the conflict comes in. Now, letter A, we talked about it a little bit, a materialistic society. And so when you think about a materialistic society, you have to identify, is it God or is it money that's controlling your life? Is it the Lord that has the preeminence, or is it chasing after money? And then we talked about, we're an entertained society. And I remember reading a quote years ago that said that you can take anything you want away from Americans, but you can't take away their entertainment. And they're not going to give that up. Well, that has created a problem, because now there's a conflict between God and recreation. And if God is God, then we ought to be worshiping him. And we have to be careful that our recreation, there's nothing wrong with recreation, but it cannot replace our God. Why? Because we develop a form of godliness, but we're denying the power thereof. And so, God and recreation, it affects, this matter of God and recreation affects the church, because there's a need to make things more and more exciting, and we have to watch out for that. And the world, listen, that world outpaces and outspends the church when it comes to entertainment, and a church that's just trying to keep up with the trends in society when it comes to entertainment is not going to make it. You financially can't make it. You physically can't make it. And certainly your talents, it cannot match what is in the world. And so this matter of trying to serve two masters, God and recreation, affects the church. It affects people, because people become more and more familiar, desensitized to what is going on in the world. And people, hey, let me say this. Every program that is on your television or in the movies or whatever is spreading some type of propaganda.
Amen.
It is molding you, informing you into what the world wants you to be. And the more you watch that stuff, the more you're consumed with that stuff, the more desensitized you are. Things that you would never say years ago is mainstream conversation nowadays. And things that were considered to be, and I've had kids do that, they say different things in school, and I say, you can't talk that way. I've called parents in and said, your children can't say these inappropriate words in conversations. And I had one father look me right in the eye and told me, he said, well, we talk like that around our house all the time. And I said, well, you may talk that way in your house, but you're not going to talk that way here.
Amen.
And so how does that affect people? Kids, adults alike, become desensitized to what's being presented and on the screen in the form of entertainment. And so it affects the church, it affects the church people, and it affects the family. Because we have developed a wrong sense of values and priorities. Probably 20 years ago, they really started downplaying and being aggressive against and mocking male leadership in the home. And the father was not considered as being necessary in the home. The sitcoms and everything presented that type of environment. And so what do we have today? I mean, they've not only eliminated men, but now they're eliminating women, because a man says, I'm a woman. And so now I saw this thing, woman was complaining because she had to fill out this paperwork. And when she put down on the paper who she was, what was the relationship to her kids, she put down their parent. And the person there, the receptionist, said, well, instead of putting parent here, that didn't really identify you. I mean, can you put mother? down there, and the woman said this: no, I don't identify as a mother, I'm a parent, I'm non-binary. I'm like, are we absolutely ludicrous?
Yeah.
And people, the sad thing is Christians will argue with me that the world does not affect them. And I'm telling you right now, it does. And probably 90% of the problems in the church is because of the fact that people have become desensitized to what's going on in the world, because it's ever before you, and your value system goes down.
Yeah.
And then the home becomes dysfunctional.
Amen.
And when the home's dysfunctional, the church is dysfunctional. And society is dysfunctional. So it's impossible to serve two masters. It affects the family. So materialistic society, entertained society, a compromising society. That sets up this matter of God and Satan. Certainly Elijah was very clear, how long halt you between two opinions? If God be God, then worship him. If Baal be God, then worship him. You can't have it both ways. But everybody wants to have it both ways. So I didn't plan on spending that much time on that point, but I liked it. I'm glad I said it. Number three, we went over this, Christian impossibilities. Impossible not to produce fruit. In other words, you're producing some type of fruit. Jesus said that a good tree cannot produce bad fruit. And so you are producing some type of fruit in your life. And that fruit that you're producing, the little asterisk there, reveals who or what you are. And a tree that drops an apple on the ground, you can't look at it and say, well, that identifies as a peach tree. It's not a peach tree, it's an apple tree. That's how ludicrous we're getting. We are saved. If you're saved, 1 John 3:9 says we will not commit sin. That doesn't mean we're sinless perfection. It means that you cannot habitually continue in sin. Don't be conviction on your heart. I would be troubled in my soul if I never was convicted by God. If I sat and heard preaching and I wasn't convicted, I'd be troubled by that. If I'm reading my Bible and I'm not convicted, I'd be troubled by that. Why? Because the Spirit of God is the one who reveals to us the temptations that are consuming us, the sin that is grasping us, and the reality is I cannot successfully continue in sin because God's not going to let go of me. He's going to bring conviction on me. Then the fruit of Jesus Christ. We're going to be looking at John 15 in a few minutes, so I don't want to spend a lot of time on that. The fruit of the Spirit, Galatians chapter 5. Is prevalent, and so it's impossible not to produce fruit. You are producing fruit, and the fruit you're producing is revealing who you are. Out of the abundance of the heart, a man speaketh, and so you can't not produce fruit. It's impossible, number four there, to be a disciple of Christ without self-denial. And Jesus was very clear, you have to take up your cross and follow him. We're not willing to deny ourselves. We cannot be a disciple of Christ. And so comparing relationships in Luke chapter 14 and verse 26, I put these down for you. Wives are submit to their husbands. And you say, well, that just isn't going to work for me. Well, it's self-denial. It's acknowledging God's form or role or establishment of the home. And he says, wives, submit to your husbands. Husbands, love your wives. I've done marital counseling. I've had guys come in and say, I just don't love her anymore. And I always tell them, you can't get off the hook that easy. God commands you to love your wife. It's not a suggestion. It's not hoping that you will. You're to love your wife, period. And love your wives. Children are to honor their parents. And the Bible's very clear. It's the first commandment with promise. That you might be have long days on the face of the earth. And then our love and devotion to our family, when it's compared to our love for Jesus Christ, should be a dramatic difference. In other words, we love our family. God tells us to love our families. But our love for the Lord is supposed to be so much greater and in comparison one with another. And so this matter of comparing relationships, then dying to self in letter B there, and then letter C is counting the cost. And if we're going to be a disciple of Christ, it requires us to deny ourselves. And so that brings us up to where we left off. Number five there, it's impossible to get along without other Christians. And that's so important to understand, because we have a tendency in the world that we live in that say, well, we don't need church, we don't need to go to church. I've had people tell me that over the years. Well, I don't need to go to church, I can worship the Lord in my house. Well, you're violating the very principle not to forsake the assembling of yourselves together. As a matter of some is, but so much more as you see the day approaching, that's the return of Christ. Why does he say that? Because we need each other. We are the body of Christ. And Paul deals with that in 1 Corinthians 12. Notice he says in verse 12, yeah, we're connected in one body. It says, for as the body is one and hath many members, and all the members of that one body being many are one body, so also is Christ. And so we need to have that mindset that we're one body. Now, we're a part of Christ, and because we're in Christ and we're a part of that one body, we need each other. My hand can't function very well if my arm doesn't move it around. And so oftentimes the church is not functioning properly because of the fact we get the idea we don't need one another. And we have this, I call it freelance Christianity. And we wonder why so many people struggle and fall by the wayside. Ministry, why? We're connected in one body, so we're to minister to each other. Notice in verse 13, for by one spirit we are all baptized in one body, whether we be Jews or Gentiles, whether we bond or free, and have been all made to drink into one spirit, for the body is not one member, but many. And so when you get saved, you're automatically in the body. You're already automatically signed up. You're already obligated to minister to one another. Because he says, if the foot say, because I am not the hand, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? And if the ear shall say, because I am not the eye, I am not of the body, is it therefore not the body of the body? If the whole body were an eye, where were the hearing? If the whole were hearing, where were the smelling? But now God hath set the members, every one of them, in the body as it hath pleased him. And if there were all one member, where were the body? And so that concept of ministering to one another takes place and is effective because of the fact we understand that we need each other. Everybody has a function within the body of Christ. And I know if God's given spiritual gifts to every one of us, then if the church is suffering in some area of ministry and coming up short, it's not because God has not provided the means and assets as far as individuals in the church. It means that I'm not surrendering my gift that God has given me. And we're to minister to one another. And then it's a joint experience. Notice in verse 26. He says, and whether one member suffer, all members suffer with it. Or one member be honored, all the members rejoice with it. Now ye are the body of Christ and members in particular. And so it's a joint experience. If somebody's recognized for a service they've done in the church or whatever, don't get jealous of that. I mean, I try to recognize people at different times and anniversaries of the church. It's amazing to me how many times I've had people come to me and get mad because we gave an award or something to somebody. I'm like, come on, get real. Yeah. You know, I mean, we have to understand that every one of us are jointly connected together to experience and move in the presence of God. And when that is not taking place, there's a disconnect, a disjoint, if you will, and it becomes a negative experience. So when somebody is being acknowledged, say somebody served the Lord and did ministry, and we want to acknowledge them, we ought to rejoice together, because that's part of our body that's being blessed. And if somebody is hurting, they're in the hospital, or they've gotten out of church for whatever, it ought to hurt us. I've had people over the years tell me, somebody stopped coming to church, and I've heard people say, I knew they wouldn't last long. Well, what kind of attitude is that? I thought we're supposed to be brethren, that if somebody's taken over in a fall, we either are spiritual, and that's where the problem comes in. We're not spiritual. We're supposed to restore such a one in a spirit of meekness, considering ourselves, lest we also be tempted. It's a joint experience. When somebody's falling by the wayside, it ought to hurt us, because it's like you cutting your finger off. If somebody is experiencing a blessing, God's blessed them financially, I don't know, they've been acknowledged or whatever, we ought to rejoice. That's a part of our body that God has been blessing. And we are able to enjoy a joint experience. Then there's edification. Ephesians chapter 4, Paul tells us about what God has supplied to this body. In Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 11, it says, and he gave some apostles and some prophets, some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. And here's why: for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. That's what it's all about. We're to edify, we're to build up one another, because we are the body of Christ. And so we need to have a world that sees us as functioning different than what everyone else does, because we have the Lord with us and we're exalting his name by how we act with each other. It's impossible to get along without other Christians. We need one another. I know my wife and I, when we first went out to start the church up in Oakhurst, one of the things that was really difficult to deal with is we went from going to a church that ran 3,000-4,000 people, being involved in bus ministry every Sunday, picking up, 70, 75 people on the bus every Sunday, going to Bible college and interacting with one another, having prayer times with one another, asking God to meet our needs, experiencing all that interconnection with each other as the body of Christ. And we went out to start a church, and it was me and her. That was it. Now, I'm going to tell you something. There was a void in our life spiritually, and it's because of the fact that we needed brothers and sisters in Christ, in the body of Christ. But and hallelujah, we were able to lead people to the Lord, and people started coming out of the church. But we need to be reminded of that. And because of the fact, and then when we left Oakhurst and was seeking God's will, where he wanted us to be, what he wanted us to do, it was amazing the negative responses of people. I remember back to my home church, my wife, it was the lowest point in our life. Spiritually, physically, emotionally, we were just about destroyed. And I walk into church, and first thing somebody comes there is, oh, what, are you quitting ministry now? I felt like looking at them and saying, do you understand how bad I'm hurting right now? Wouldn't it be nice to understand that I'm a part of the body of Christ? And it would be nice if you reached out and tried to encourage me? But the sad thing is, that's the way people act in church, because you don't understand that we need each other. Amen. And there needs to be a reaching out to help one another. Not by just the pastor, not by the deacons, but by every one of us in the church. Clear testimony, John chapter 17 in verse 23. It says, I in them and thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one, that the world may know that thou hast sent me and hast loved me, and thou hast loved love them as thou hast loved me. Very clear presentation, a very clear experience when we understand that we're connected together in the body of Christ. And so it's impossible to live without other Christians. Well, James chapter 3, number 6 there, it's impossible to tame the tongue. And when you think you've tamed your tongue, that's a good time to fast and pray and say, God, help me keep my tongue under control. Because that's when it's going to get loose, amen? And letter A there is just simply this. You cannot tame it. In James chapter 3, in verse 7 and 8, James chapter 3, verse 7 and 8 says, every kind of beast and birds and serpents and of all of the things in the sea is tamed and hath been tamed of mankind. But the tongue can no man tame. It is an unruly evil, full of deadly poison. So we need to remind ourselves how much we need to watch over our tongue. I put in your notes there, it's the same, the Greek word for tame there in verse 8 is the same Greek word that's used in Mark chapter 5 and verse 4. You can look it up later. But in Mark chapter 5 and verse 4, it's talking about the maniac of Gadara. Men had tied him up, chained him up, he'd break out into chains. And it says in Mark chapter 5 and verse 4 that no man could tame him. Exact same Greek word is used here in James. And you look at this man, he was a maniac. He was out of control. He was demon-possessed. And everybody was trying to control him. And nobody could control him. And James says that's the same problem that we have with our tongue. I don't know about you. That's serious business. And so I need the Lord to help me. The Bible has much to say about speaking. In Acts chapter 26 and verse 25, it tells us here, as the Apostle Paul is before Festus, if I remember correctly, in Acts chapter 26 and verse 25, he says to him, he said, I am not mad. This is Paul responding to the accusation of Festus. I am not man, most noble Festus. And here it is. But speak forth the words of truth and soberness. So this matter of our speech, you cannot control or tame your tongue. And so that means you have to be speaking truth with soberness, saying that which is honest and trustworthy, and saying it in a way that we're under the control of the Holy Spirit of God. Not be not drunk with wine where is in excess, but be filled with the Holy Spirit. And so I need to allow the Spirit of God to guide my conversations, because my conversations will be wrong. And you can see in your notes there some thoughts about this. Letter number 2 there is to speak in agreement. We're supposed to be in agreement one with another. Amos 3:3 says, can two walk together except they be agreed? And so we need to have our speech patterned after the speech of Christ and after the word of God. 1 Corinthians 1:10 says, now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, that ye all speak the same thing, and that there be no divisions among you, but that ye be perfectly joined together in the same mind and the same judgment. That's why Paul said in Philippians 2, let this mind be in you also, which was in Christ Jesus. That like-mindedness that guides and directs our conversation so that we're in agreement. Then we're supposed to speak truth in love. That's what Ephesians 4:15, speaking the truth in love. And I've had people say, well, you know, I just told them, but I thought, well, probably didn't say it very lovingly. You might have to rebuke somebody. You might have to correct the situation, but you can certainly ask the Lord to help you speak in love. And then number 4 there, we're to speak with psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. And making a melody in our heart, it says in Ephesians 5:19. And it would be well for you to develop a conversation or a thought process that your speech is directed by what the Word of God has to say, that's Psalms, directed by hymns. You know, the sad thing is, I'm seeing this in many churches, present day churches, modern churches, I guess. Nobody knows the hymns anymore. They don't sing the hymns. Sorry to sing other things, but they don't sing the hymns. And the hymns are great doctrinal foundations that we need to sing. I need to, when I'm going through the day, I need to speak to myself in Psalms. I need to know what the Scripture says. I need to speak to myself in hymns. I need to sing some psalms in my heart. And spiritual psalms. There are those psalms that minister to your heart and speak of the grace of God. And so it's better to sing those songs and think on those words than it is to listen to the corrupted words and psalms that are in the world.
Amen.
And so it's impossible to tame my tongue, and so I got to put something in my brain, in my mind, on my conscience that's going to guard my tongue so I won't say that which is inappropriate. And then, of course, James 1:19, we're supposed to be slow to speak. Slow to speak. All right, so that took me all that time to get up to when there's just my addition I put on there. It's impossible, here's the last thought, it's impossible to be fruitful as a Christian without Jesus Christ. In John chapter 15, in verses 1 through 8, we'll get over there, I'll read those verses for you real quick. We won't read all of those verses, but John chapter 15, in verses 1 through 8, tells us this. He says, I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. And every branch that beareth fruit, he purges it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now ye are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine, no more can ye except you abide in me. It is impossible to be fruitful as a Christian without being in Christ, abiding in Christ. And so here's three aspects of that matter, abiding in Christ. First of all, Christian character. I cannot have the proper Christian character. I cannot have fruit as a Christian in my life that depicts and shows forth the character of Christ if I'm not walking with Christ, if I'm not devoted to Christ. So the Christian character, emotionally. In Galatians chapter 5, we often identify the fruit of the Spirit in verse 22 and 23. But notice it says here, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, and peace. Love, joy, and peace is emotional. Love is emotional. Joy is emotional. Peace is emotion. And so I want to be able to have love. I want to have joy. I don't want to have peace. I want to be, in other words, emotionally stable in my life. How am I going to do that? I can't do it apart from Christ. And so I need to have time alone with God each day. I need time to read the Scriptures, let the Lord speak to my heart. I need to be thinking on who He is all day long. When I start to get sad or I feel like nobody cares and I start losing my peace, I have to focus on Christ. Because I can't have the joy and I can't have the peace, and I certainly cannot be able to have the fruit of love in my life if I'm not walking with God. I need to have Christian character, and that Christian character is dependent upon me being with Christ, because it's impossible to bear fruit without Christ. And so emotional. Verse 22 in the middle of the verse is relational. Notice in verse 22 it says, love, joy, peace. Then it says, long-suffering, gentleness, and goodness. That based on relations. We're supposed to be long-suffering to one another. How can I do that? I can't put up with you. You can't put up with me apart from the Spirit of God. It is the fruit of the Spirit that gives us the ability to endure relationships in our life. Now, gentleness, that's how we relate one toward another. Being kind, goodness, all that has to deal with relationship problems or positive things. How can I do that? I can't do that apart from Christ. And so I have to abide in Christ. And then not only emotional and relational, but spiritual. Because it says the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace. We understand it's emotional. Long-suffering, gentleness, goodness. We understand that's relational. Faith, meekness, and temperance. That's very clear. It's talking about a spiritual condition. And so I need to have faith that is growing. I need to be humble and meek. You know, the Bible says that Moses was the meekest man on the whole earth. I need the meekness of God. I'm going to tell you, that doesn't come from the flesh, and it certainly doesn't come from the world, because we're living in a world that is so angry and so upset about everything.
Amen.
So how can I not get caught up with that? I need to be spiritual. I need the fruit of the Spirit. And then it says, not only that, but temperance. Temperance means to be under control. Proverbs 11:3 says, the integrity of the upright shall guide him, but the perverseness of transgressors shall destroy them. And that is, listen, this matter of Christian character is what the problem is in the world today. The world doesn't have any Christian character. And the sad thing is, far too many Christians are not living up to the Christian character. There's no fruit. There's no fruit of the Spirit in their life. Because they're trying to be spiritual or trying to do ministry on all kinds of other bases, when Jesus said, without me you can do nothing. You have to abide in me. And so if your relationship with Christ is suffering for whatever the reason, we need to get back to abiding in Christ. And so Christian character. Then I put down Christian conduct. And Christian conduct is simply this, walking in truth. And I don't have time to look up the verses, but look up Psalm 25, verse 4 and 5, and it's very clear the psalmist is talking about walking in truth. We have lost truth today. Truth in the churches, truth in our society, truth in our schools. We need to walk in truth. Why? Because we need to develop obedience, or need to be obeying the truth. And it does no good to have truth in front of us and then walk in it and identify it and then refuse to obey it. Romans chapter 2 and verse 8 says, but unto them that are contentious and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, indignation and wrath, tribulation and anguish upon every soul of man that doeth evil, of the Jew first and also of the Gentile. So there's got to be this Christian character that is based on being in Christ. There has to be this Christian conduct that is a fruit that's manifesting itself through us because we understand the truth of Christ and we obey what he has revealed. And then I just put down Christian converts. Because fruit, I believe, deals with us bringing others to Christ. And so the span of this matter of converts. Psalm 127:1 says, except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain to build it. And so when you think of the spans of reaching people for Christ, the Lord has to build the house. God's been blessing us as a church and as a ministry. People are getting saved. People are joining the church. I think we have 7 people that's joined the church on Sunday. We've had people, 6 or 7 people get baptized this past Sunday. God is, it's not any work of man, I can tell you that. It's God doing a work of grace. And so we have to realize, except the Lord build the house. Man can't build the house.
Amen.
God has to build the house, the span. Then the security. I love Isaiah chapter 1. I'd like to read that verse over there. In Isaiah chapter 1 and verse 9. Dealing with and talking about the security that we have in Christ. Isaiah chapter 1 and verse 9 tells us this. It says, except the Lord of hosts had left us a very small remnant, we should have been as Sodom, and we should have been like unto Gomorrah.
Amen.
That's security that we have in Christ. If it wasn't for the security of God, and if it wasn't for the grace of God to leave us a remnant, we would be like Sodom and Gomorrah that were destroyed by God because of their sin. Security. Then surrender. John 3:3, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of heaven. Christian converts, the span, the security, the surrender, the Savior. Paul said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it's the power of God unto salvation. Philippians chapter 3, verse 10, Paul said, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection. And so the Savior, and then just sinners. When you think about this fruit of salvation in the sinner is just simply, in Luke 18, publican went down to the temple to pray, and all he did was just cry out, God, be merciful unto me, a sinner. And so the fruit that's produced in our life depends completely on who Christ is and what he is doing in our life. And so it's impossible. Listen, it is impossible to have fruit without Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And you can go to seminars and you can do all kinds of things. You can have all kinds of group studies and all this, that, and the other. But if you're not abiding in Christ, you're not going to produce fruit. And so there's some verses on there. Make sure you look up those Bible verses. We weren't able to look them all up. I hope that was a blessing to you. Well, we need to pray tonight. You have your prayer sheet there in front of you. Is there anything that we need to add to the list tonight? And anybody? Yeah, Tom.
My grandson, Ben, he's autistic. They just found out that he has stigmatization in both eyes.
Okay.
You can't get anywhere near this kid. To put the glasses on. So I asked a prayer for my daughter because she has rough time on it.
Okay. All right, so pray for Tom's grandson and that he has pigmentation in his eye, and I also pray for his Tom's daughter. Be sure to keep praying for Isabella Gold. I know she was in the hospital. I haven't heard word anything as far as if she got home yet or not. So keep praying for her as she's recuperating from the surgery. She had. Anything else? Yes, ma'am.
Actually, you know, Gordon's family was up before mine passed.
Okay.
And
what's that?
Gordon's family's up before mine.
Oh, all right. Barbara?
Okay, thank you. I'd just like to pray for the people at 35 Broad Street after the fire a few months ago. Teresa's still trying to get in back into her apartment, and she's living in a cellar in her friend's house. So just to pray for Teresa with the stress situation, she's pretty stressed out. And for the people who have they're still back in the 35 Broad Street after the fire.
Okay, just pray for folks who got displaced from the fire. And that they'll be able to get back in there, some housing there. Amen. Bam.
Care for my son-in-law Gerard in Holland. He's having some kind of neurological episode, and they don't know what it's about. He has a doctor appointment, but pray for the salvation, please, and for some understanding about what is happening.
Sure. Okay. Let's pray for Gerard. This neurological episode and be able to figure out what's going on there. Amen. And for his salvation. All right. Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer. I'm sorry. Yes, Derek.
It's kind of going to be a rant, so I apologize in advance. But I'm going to pray for our school, definitely our church, and definitely our children in the school, because in my family, they're minors, so I'm not going to say their name, but my nephew is indoctrinated, and he's been affected by this whole transgender movement. And it's just hard to, when you say about Christian impossibilities, when his parents are okay with it and encourage R100 cat out there.
Mm-hmm.
And I see it firsthand. And they're trying to make us think that we're the minority in the way that we think when we're not.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody I talk to, whether going to church or not, we're all on the same page. That this is just insanity. And but if you say anything about it, if you get on your keyboard and you start trying to be an internet warrior, you know, the everything comes down on you. So the hard part is right now is that the one thing that we rely on the most is now the only thing that we got, and that's the power of prayer. And because even today it came out that now they're embracing walking with Satan. They're saying this out loud, and they're encouraging it that since God don't want us, we'll walk with Satan proudly. And as we all have seen over the years, it's just getting just crazier and crazier, and I just, let alone your lifetime, my lifetime, my life, it's just, we are under attack, but yet, we're also being muzzled when we can't voice our own, our own thoughts and beliefs anymore either, and so, I don't want to say his name, but if you could just pray for my nephew. I just pray that nothing's allowed to be done that can't be undone. Because he's just a child. You know, he's 13 years old. You can't tell him. You know, he's barely able to pick his bedtime, but he can pick his gender. Like, this is insanity. So, I don't know. Sorry about the rant.
And trans is less than 1% of our population. And yet, everybody, if you say something against it, they're jumping all over you. So the only answer is we need to pray, and we need to be vocal. We need to say, well, no, that's not right, you know. And so we'll be praying for you about that.
Our kids that are here, to protect them from what's going on out there.
That's all you can do.
That's the most important.
And so pray. God's been blessing our Christian school. And you need to pray that God will give us strength to be able to continue to stand, because you get it from all different angles. And it's not going to get any easier. So the devil is hard at work. All we need to do is preach the gospel, take a stand, and just say we're not going to give up. And God is still on the throne, He's still in control, and God can change things if we trust Him and believe Him. Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer, and please take some time and pray tonight. We desperately need prayer, and because we can't do it on our own, and we need the power and the grace of God. Amen. God bless you for being here.